I'm good, so are you?
I'm wonderful, wonderful. So we're gonna just let's say wait maybe 5 more minutes to see if anyone else actually pitches up. If no one pitches up, then we'll get started.
All right, okay,
Yeah.
sure.
Anyways, how are things going on your side?
Yeah, I'm trying, sir. To be honest, this journey of fundamentals is it's not easy. But I can see the impact because I've been reviewing the markets. I can see that, for example, today
Yeah.
Iran-Israel attack on that thing of risk on, risk off. I think it's becoming more visible that the fundamental side of things is it's true that fundamentals need to affect the market because I've
Exactly.
been I've been I think a few weeks for some few weeks now I've been checking the CPIs and what
Yeah.
they are affecting the market the way you used to see. But yeah, I still have a problem. I still have a problem because I think the problem is with me now, not the market. Because what I'm doing now is I want, for example, I've been looking at interest rates for
Yeah.
the, I think it was 2015, 2019. Maybe let's say the news came for interest rates today, but the move is gonna happen a month later. So the problem for now I can say is that thing of I want things to happen now. That's my problem. I want things to happen now. If let's say the news for interest rates came in today,
Yeah.
I want to see the move maybe today or tomorrow. So I think that's the main problem for me now. But to be honest, yeah, I can see that fundamentals are working. They are working.
They are
They are
working. So
working. But
for
they are
you at
working.
the moment, it's just that you want it to happen today. If the news come out today, then with regards to interest rates, you'd expect the move to happen today.
Yeah, I think that that's the main problem I have now. I with knowing when exactly, because I've been checking your statuses. You are good at knowing when. I think that that's the other part will help us with the when part. The when part. I think that's the problem most of us are suffering with, the when part.
Yeah, here's how I can put it. I can try and make it simpler for you. Fundamentals, they put you a step ahead of the market. If you can try and accept that, then things will be easier. That markets will put you a step ahead. If you've done your analysis and you're good with it, then the markets will put you a step ahead. If you want to trade data or you want moves that happen instantly on the same time on like on the same day when you get the actual news release, if you want moves that start happening then you need to trade data specifically. So what do I mean? I mean that if we're getting CPI released for the United Kingdom, right, for EGBP England, then you need to see whether the news is positive or negative, and then also interpret it how it will affect markets or the Bank of England's interest rate decisions moving forward, and then you react on that. That is the only way you can trade news like instantly. But other than that, if you're looking at the macro picture, looking at the geopolitical landscape, you have to wait. There's no other way. You have to wait because sometimes you come across news, but the market is, let's say, news, for example, to buy, let's say, to buy oil, but oil keeps on rising. It's pointless for you to chase oil. You need to wait for oil to pull back first to correct and then look to buy. The fact that you have came with the fundamental bias that you're looking to buy oil, but then oil keeps on running higher and higher, you know, not it does not mean that now you need to shift your bias and say, okay, since oil is high, let me try and sell and then I'll try and buy it lower. No, just stick to your bias so that when it falls, you are not involved emotionally. Because whenever you're in a trade, you are going to be involved emotionally, right? So if you sell, but your main bias was to buy and now you're selling just because oil keeps on running high and high, and now you're like, I know you're trying to pick that top and you're selling. When the time comes for you to buy, if your sell trade is in profit, it will be difficult for you to close that sell trade. and convince yourself that our oil will start moving up. So you now emotionally invest, because whenever you pay for something, which is why I always say as well, with regards to anything, whether it's mentorship, whether it's to study, whether it's to do something, whenever someone pays, they become emotionally invested in something compared to when they're getting it for free. They become emotionally invested, and the term that they generally use, if you pay, you pay attention, right? But I'm just trying to say, at that point, you now have an emotion, you are emotionally invested in the sell trade that is running in profits, and you're gonna hesitate on executing a buy trade when the right time comes for you to execute a buy trade. So that is why I always say, yeah, that is why I think I posted real, and then I wrote a pretty long description of it. And I was talking about the same thing, that I'm not, whenever I'm looking at an asset class, whether it's a currency pair or gold or oil or whatever it may be, or Bitcoin, I never go in there with two biases. Because if I have two biases, then I'll, to a certain extent, I'm human, I'm going to confuse myself, or I'll hesitate buying because I'm also thinking that there is a potential for me to sell. But if I'm focusing on one thing, and that is why my entries are, let me say 90% of the time, my entries are accurate. Because whenever, like I'm just making an example with oil, if I've told myself that fundamentals say I should buy, I do not care what happens. Even if it continues rallying higher, even if it gives me a double top, if I'm using patterns as an opportunity to sell, I will not sell. I will wait for price to fall, and then I will buy. And that is why I get those sniper entries, because my focus is only on buying.
Oh, so what happens when let's say the interest rates are positive, but the data is the other? Let's say, because I've seen in many instances the interest rates, let's say, are positive for the euro, negative for the dollar, but the euro will keep on falling, even
So,
though the
you said interest rates are positive for
the euro.
Okay, yeah. And they negative for the dollar.
Yeah,
okay,
obvious that is,
but euro USD will keep on falling lower.
yes, for a very long time.
What
Yeah,
is the
so
what is here's another important thing. Whenever,
yeah,
okay, no, continue with your question. Finish your question before I answer.
Yeah, I was asking that. So what is happening on that situation? When you have a euro that is very foreign, let's say 3 weeks, but the data is positive.
Okay. This, when it comes to fundamentals, another very important thing that gives you good trading opportunities is what we call divergence. Divergence means they are moving in opposite directions from a common point, right? So the bigger the divergence, by that I mean interest rates. What is the divergence between interest rates? Yes, interest rates can come in positive, or maybe let's say they hike interest rates for the euro, but then for the dollar, let's say maybe they hold interest rates, right? Then markets keeps on falling for who? For the euro. Why? Because there's a huge divergence, not only on the interest rate side of things, but also remember what I keep on saying. Interest rates drive everything, but inflation drives interest rates. What is inflation doing? How is the labor market doing? By labor market, I mean unemployment, wages, and all of that. How is that doing as well? If there's a divergence there as well, then even news that can be positive for the euro, it will just be a small spike up, but then it will continue going lower because there's a very huge divergence. A lot of weakness on the euro, and a lot of strength on the dollar. Even though we, from time to time, we might have positive news for the euro, they will give euro just a little boost, but markets will continue selling. Why? Because there is that divergence between the two. So that's a very key thing to also understand, the divergence. That's number one. Then number two, it is how significant is it to the future? Because remember what I said when we started, right? When you were talking about you not being patient enough to wait for the trade, for your entry, or for the market to actually give you that opportunity.
Yeah.
Everything works on the central banks and how it will affect, especially when you're trading forex, how it will affect future decisions. So that interest rate coming in, or that, let's say, positive news for the euro, does it have a huge impact on the decisions moving forward? If not, then it's just data. If the central bank, if like for example, the Bank of Japan, right, before they started increasing interest rates, they kept on saying they're focusing on wages and they're focusing on inflation. So any other data that can come, it won't have much of a significant impact because that is not the data that the central bank is focusing on for them to actually what? For them to actually adjust their monetary policy. So it is also very important to have an understanding of that. What is this data significant to impact the next meeting's decision? Right? Is this will this data cause the central bank to cut interest rates or cause them to keep interest rates high or maybe potentially hike interest rates? So all of those things, you need to be clued up with all of those things. And it's not difficult, just that it's something that you need to do in the preparation stage, right? Because there's also one question that I always like to ask people, that what is the difference between a professional and an amateur in any arena, not only in trading, but in any arena? You give me your best guess. What do you think is the difference between a professional and an amateur?
Okay, I think experience. Maybe you've been doing this for too long, and you have practiced long enough. I think time is, I think, in my opinion, time is
Okay,
the
okay.
important factor here.
Gift, you can chip in there as well.
Yeah, I think definitely be that it's experience more than anything else.
Okay, yeah, there's no right or wrong answer. You guys are both on point. You're both on point. But to sum it up, like Nick said at some point, it is practice. It is the difference between amateurs and professionals is that professionals spend 10 times more time in preparation or practicing than performing. But amateurs spend 10 times less time preparing or practicing than they do perform. Right. So in this realm, when it comes to us in our industry, it is, yeah, gift.
Yeah, I'm sorry to jump in just like that.
Yeah.
I want to ask a question, right? In relation to, for example, let's take two different currencies, right? And let's say, for instance, they are both bound to cut their interest rates to a certain percentage. Let's take, for example, AUD and PEG, right? They are both trying to cut the interest rate to say 2%, right?
Wait, wait,
Do you
Gift.
think
Sorry, Gift. Let me cut you short there. Let me complete the statement and then you can continue asking. Yeah, okay. I thought maybe you were asking with regards to this.
so
So, I was saying that as also Nick also stated, and you also stated, it is the practice. So in the realm of what we do, which is trading, most retail traders, what we like to do, we like to perform more than we practice, right? We like to perform more than we prepare. So I'm going back to answer what I was saying to Nick, that it is not difficult. It's not a difficult task, but because we all rushing to perform rather than to prepare, that is where we fall short. Because if you look at professionals in any other arena as well, they prepare more than they perform. Cristiano Ronaldo, one of the greatest football players, right? Lionel Messi, right? They only play for 90 minutes, unless there's extra time and all of that. But generally, a football game is 90 minutes. But they only practice for hours and hours. You see? Even in even 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 in basketball, it's the same thing. Whether it's Michael Jordan, any who's Steph Curry and all of those people, they practice for hours and hours and hours and hours, so that when it comes the time for them to perform, they make it seem so effortless. It looks easy to someone who's looking at them. Not because it's easy, but because they spent a lot of time in preparation. So now, what do I mean when it comes to trading? I spend a lot of time in preparation, making sure that I'm up to date with everything. I'm aware of what is happening. Even when news are actually released, I need to know beforehand what impact it will have, if it comes out positive, if it comes out negative, you know? So that is what I mean by preparation. That is how you also need to approach fundamentals. They're not difficult, just that you're not used to preparing. Right? Like you said, you're struggling to wait for the setup to actually come to fruition, because you now have a fundamental bias. You want it to happen now. No, the time will come. But for you, make sure that you always prepared, so that when the time comes, it will reveal you that you were prepared. Because if the time comes and you were not prepared, it will expose you that you were not prepared. Right? So that is the mindset that you need to have when it comes to fundamentals. It's very easy. It's very easy. But you need to spend more time in the preparation phase. And then it will be easier for you to perform. And just by performing, I mean trading, and just trade and execute trades. And everyone is like, yo, this trade is so good. To you, yeah, it is a good trade, but it's like I prepared well in advance for it. When are you just seeing the final product of it, you see? So that is just the difference there when it comes to professionals and amateurs. So that is how you also need to approach fundamentals. It's not difficult. Like I always say, interest rates drive everything, but inflation drives interest rates. If you grasp those two concepts, and then you now understand what causes inflation to be high, what causes inflation to be low, it's game over. It's game over. You've grasped 50% of the fundamental analysis from there, because everything else just builds into that. Everything else just builds into that. It builds into inflation, it builds into interest rates, and then so it's
Okay,
not, yeah.
so I have a question. So if you notice, there is qualitative data and quantitative data in this fundamental space. Let's
Yeah.
see. Okay, so I'm not sure if this is the right question to ask, but which one more most important? Because let's say the according to what I noticed, the most active is the qualitative side of things, whereby we are looking at all these different factors and the effect and what and what. Then we have the data that is released, which is the quantitative, the data that is
Yeah.
released maybe
Yeah.
once a month. So which one is
Exactly.
more, so which one is most important to focus on, the qualitative or the quantitative side of things?
That's the thing. Don't look at
And
it. Don't look at it. Don't look at it in that way. I'll answer you in a very short way. Don't look at it in that way, in trying to figure out which is important and which is more important and which is less important, because they're both important. Because for you to get the qualitative data, here's what you need to remember. That is why I always say the quantitative data, not to say it's more important, but that is the foundation. Because for the Fed to make the decision, the Federal Reserve will tell you that we're looking at core PCE, or we're looking at core inflation, we're looking at the labor market. They will tell you all of those things, which is what? That is the quantitative data. So if you are also paying attention to the quantitative data, and you know what is happening with the quantitative data side of things, then it's easier for you to do what? To understand the qualitative. So they all work in hand in hand. But understand that whenever you're reading the qualitative side, whenever you're reading a financial news article, whenever you're reading a financial news article, it is based on what? On the quantitative. It is based on the numbers. It is based on whether it's GDP, it's interest rates, and all of that, for them to actually formulate that qualitative analysis of saying we expect the pound to go lower because of A, B, C, D, blah, 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 blah. It's all stemming from the numbers, because they are also looking at the numbers. Yes, they may have different models, but they generally just looking at the numbers.
Okay, so another question I have I went to trading economics. Then what I noticed there is that in the past few years, the euro have maintained, I think, higher, not sure, higher or lower interest rates than the US. But there have been up and down fluctuations, even though the other has higher interest rates than the other for years. So what is the most important data, or what to look for in between, or what to, I don't know how to ask it, but what to look for in between, let's say the interest rates of the euro side have been higher than the US for 5 years, but there's been up and down fluctuations in the market. So what may be the cause of that?
It goes back to the thing that I said initially. What is the divergence there? What is the other data telling you? Because that plays a role. And also remember, the United States dollar is a world reserve currency. It is a world reserve currency. So a lot of factors, it is sensitive to a lot of factors that are happening globally. But essentially, it starts with that. What is the, how big, what is the divergence between the two central banks? Because yes, interest rates, what example can I make? Euro-CHF. Euro-CHF has been falling. But interest rates in the in the Swiss have been, before they started cutting, they went up to 1.75. But for the euro, they were sitting at what? 4.5%. They went up to 4.5% currently. But what has been happening? The Swiss has been strengthening against the euro. Why? Because it also goes to what are the other dynamics that are happening there? What is the divergence there? Of course, we know the Swiss is a very strong currency. But then you also need to pay attention to all of those things. You don't just take it at face value and say, because this one has higher interest rates and this one has lower interest rates. Okay, how is the inflation picture there? Because you also need to understand that that is nominal interest rates. I'm getting a bit technical now, but that is nominal interest rates. There's what we call real interest rates. Real interest rates is when we take the nominal interest rates. For example, we take the euro interest rate at 4.5, and then we minus inflation that is currently sitting at what? Sitting at 2.9. So now you see that there is a positive what? The interest rate, the real interest rate is now positive. So which means that investors' capital or the returns on investments are protected against inflation, because the interest rate, the nominal interest rate is higher than inflation, which gives you a positive real interest rate. So all of those things, but there is more technical. But the simple thing is, what is the divergence? Look at the data, all the other data. Was it also pointing to the same thing? Right? Because if the data was not pointing to the same thing, okay, what were the central banks more focused on? Going back to that thing, right? Because not all central banks are just focusing on unemployment. Yes, unemployment contributes to inflation, but some central banks will say, we're just focusing on wages, right? We want to see wages fall, not unemployment. Then yes, unemployment increasing would be good because it would lower inflation, but they would just say, we want to see what wages fall. So they're very specific. So you know that the data, whenever wage data comes out, it's going to move markets, because that is what the central bank is focusing on. I think we're gonna have to hold it there, and then we have to take someone else. But you were answered, right, Nick?
Yes, it makes sense. Yeah, I'm clear. It makes sense that I have to look at another data, also other things.
Okay. Gift. Welcome, gentlemen. Humphrey and Raymond. Welcome, welcome. Gift.
Yeah. No. In terms of my question, I think I'm answered by your statements that you shared.
Oh. Okay.
Questions were more of this. Humphrey asked in the same question.
Sorry, Gift. Yeah, you. Your voice is a bit low. I can't hear you.
Answered by your answers, you know, towards questions. Yeah, everything is sorted, yeah, from my side, yeah.
Okay. Then we'll get the other gentlemen if they have questions as well. Humphrey or Raymond, if you have questions, now is your opportunity. Okay, which means the two gentlemen don't have questions. Oh, Humphrey. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, good evening. Is
Evening, evening,
today
evening.
Some chat. Yes, yeah, my question, I really wanted to know what determines the direction of the market. What really determines the direction of the market?
Okay. So essentially, the basic of it, like I was answering Nick, that you need to look at all the data. What is the central bank saying? What they're looking at? What they're focusing on? What is the other data doing for you to actually get the divergence? Because remember, especially when it comes to currencies, for a trend to develop, there needs to be a divergence. The one needs to be showing strength, one needs to be showing weakness. Then we have a trending market. But if they're both showing strength or if they're both showing weakness, then we have a range-bound market. The market won't, yes, it will move, but it won't move much because there is no strong divergence. So that is the first thing that we need to understand. But to simplify everything, it's what I always say, that interest rates drive everything, but inflation drives interest rates. Let us go to trading view. Because you need to understand that interest rates control the spending of consumers. It controls the spending or expansion of businesses. Because if interest rates are high, everyone has, most people have debt, right? Either it's a mortgage loan or just a personal loan, or whatever loan that they have with the bank. Most people have debt, right? So, and to service that debt, they need to pay an interest to who? To the lender, right? So now, if interest rates are going up, it means that interest rates for mortgages will go up unless if it's fixed, right? But for most countries, it's not fixed. Like we have Canada, even here in South Africa, it's, yes, you can get fixed, but mostly it's not fixed. So whenever interest rates go up, it means that mortgage loans goes up, student loans, pay repayments goes up, obviously credit cards, all of that, right? Vehicle financing and just any loan that you may have or personal loan that you may have with the bank. So what that then does is that it now reduces the what? The consumer spending. And consumer spending is what? It is the fuel that drives the economy. It is the fuel that keeps the economy running and growing. Because if consumers, because now let's say before I was paying 5,000 rands for my mortgage, right? Or home loan. I was paying 5,000 rand. And then now I am paying what? Humphrey just, okay. It just got kicked out. I think we'll continue. Okay, let me just continue because I was just giving this. Okay, he's back on. Humphrey? Humphrey?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You which part did you not hear? Or before you got cut off, what was I saying at that point?
Oh, no, you were talking about let's say the inflation. If the inflation goes high, everything is being affected.
Okay. So you didn't miss much, but essentially I was still on interest rates. Yeah. So if I was paying a let's say a mortgage, a home loan, and my repayments every single month were 5,000 rands, but now interest, because inflation is high, central banks are now increasing interest rates, what happens? My repayments go from 5,000 to 6,000 within a span of, let's say, 12 months, right? They go up to 6,000 from 5,000. Now, what does that mean? That means that the 1,000 rand that I'm now coughing into my repayments, where does it come from? It comes from my disposable income. So what does that mean? That now means that
Yes.
I no longer have that 1,000 rand extra to go spend and buy whatever I want to buy, or maybe spend on a business, or maybe invest in the stock market if I'm an investor, or maybe buy Bitcoin if I want to buy Bitcoin. Why? Because I now need to direct that extra disposable income into paying back my debt, right? Because interest rates are going high. It's the same thing for businesses. When interest rates are going high, they can no longer what service the debt that they had, because interest rates or loan repayments on the business loan that they might have took is the interest payments are going up. So what will that do? That will drive what? That will drive businesses to actually what? Lay off people or to retrench people because they are struggling. And you know, if businesses are struggling, the first people they let go is because remember, paying a salary is an expense to a business. It's not a profit. Right. So they need to cut down
Yeah.
on expenses if they're struggling. So they lay off people, right? So I'm trying to give you to paint to you a picture of how the impact of that interest rates have. So whenever interest rates are going higher, we understand that they're negative for consumers, right? Because now my payment moves from 5,000 to 6,000. Secondly, they're negative for businesses because now businesses need to what? Need to pay a higher interest, which means that now that is gonna also do what? For consumers, it eats into their what disposable income, but for businesses, it eats into what their profit margins, which means now they're getting less profit because they're now paying a higher interest on their loans. So what does that do to the share price of businesses? Because profits are no longer that high, or the profit margins are decreasing, and earnings will also decrease. So what does that mean? The business will struggle. So if you are an investor, and you invest in the stock market or you invest in indices, what will you do? Once you see that the central bank is increasing interest rates, you know that business that is negative for businesses. So that means it's negative for the stock market, it's negative for indices. You are going to sell what? Indices. You're going to sell the stock market whenever interest rates are going up because you know that consumers will struggle. And if consumers are struggling, that means that businesses are no longer making that much profit because their customers can no longer come to them and buy. You know, so you start selling indices and the stock market. So essentially, that is why I always say interest rates drive everything. Because when interest rates are going lower, then you do the opposite because you know that, which means that now I'll have more money to spend. I'll have more money to invest in the stock market if I want to invest in the stock market. Businesses will no longer need to retrench people because why? Because costs of borrowing are going lower because central banks are cutting interest rates. What will that do? That is positive for businesses. If it's positive for businesses, what are businesses? The stock market is businesses. It's made up of businesses, right? What is an indice? It's a collection of businesses. So which means that whenever interest rates are gonna go lower, what will happen? You'll see a rise in the stock market because profit margins are going to increase because they're now paying less in interest back to the lenders, right? So the first thing to understand is that that is the significance that interest rates have in the general market, whether it's even Bitcoin. Why? Why? Because Bitcoin, in as much as it's decentralized, but Bitcoin is now viewed as an alternative form of investment compared to the stock market because Bitcoin moves more than the stock market, right? So that is essentially the first thing that you need to understand for you to know what really drives the market. So I'm gonna go to so that I can show you this. Right. So on my screen, I'm gonna show you. This is the United States 10-year bond yield, right? So this is the why is it not showing? Let me do the red, right? Then go up in the April 20, then 10-year and indices should do what? Anyone can answer.
Think they should do the opposite.
Sorry, Gift, you're not audible again.
I think they should do the opposite of what the
100,
energy.
yes.
Yeah,
Yes,
yeah,
100%, 100%. Because like I explained, interest rates are going up, it's gonna affect businesses, and indices are just businesses. NASDAQ is a collection of businesses. S&P 500, US
Yeah.
30, that's a collection of businesses, right? Good answer there, Gift. So what does that mean? That now means that whenever interest rates, the US 10-year is going up, we'd expect indices to go lower, right? That is essentially now answering your question, Humphrey, of what actually drives the market. It is interest rates, right? And I'm gonna show you now. So as you can see, that is the S&P 500. And as you can, inverse correlation between the two. Indices actually peak here. That is when interest rates can continue to fall, to fall, to fall. And then when it bottomed out, when indices bottomed out and interest rates actually reached their high, and then they continued to rally higher. But this was all being driven by inflation. In as much as interest rates are controlling the move, but it all stems from inflation. Because if inflation is seen as being higher, then interest rates needs to go higher. If inflation is seen as being lower, then interest fall that we're seeing on indices, in as much as it has something to do with geopolitics as well. But remember, we also had what? CPI for the United States that actually came in higher than what was expected. So what does so the US 10-year yield won't go lower because interest rates are not expected to be cut anytime soon. It will push higher. So if it pushes higher, what do we see on indices? They start falling. So as you can see from here, indices started falling, the US 10-year yield started pushing higher, right? So that is essentially what another alternative form of investment is, what is Bitcoin, right? So as you can see in 2023, so from this low in 2022, how much of yes, gift.
Basically, I wanted to know if that the interest rates are more or less like a leading indicator as to what's going to probably happen in the market in the foreseeable future, basically.
Because
Okay.
remember, when it comes to fundamentals, we're working on expectations. How is it changing expectations of the future? That is what markets may work on. What how why what, which is why they generally say it's priced in, because markets were expecting it, right? So that's when they use all that lingo of it's priced in. So as you can see from the low of 2022, stock market 8% move, right? So now I'm gonna, but it is also driven by interest rate because it is now viewed. So let us market moved to open the ever pushing higher. What did we see? We saw Bitcoin continue to push against the main high after the United States inflation data that we had. What is happening? Bitcoin has been pulling back, push higher. But from the low of 2023 that was formed in Bitcoin, right? So to the high, Bitcoin has moved 196%, right? So if you were an investor, would you invest in Bitcoin or on the stock market? Obviously, stock market is more reliable, whatnot and whatnot, but Bitcoin and the stock markets, they move literally the same when it comes to indices. Just that Bitcoin, the moves are exaggerated, and that is why it went up so high, because investors saw that even lower in 2023, they got the stock market, the sorry, Bitcoin had already bottomed in 2023. So we can't really say that actually caused this move. No, it was because interest rate that resulted in risk on environment, because now investors saw it feasible to put on risk to start buying back businesses, because when if interest rates do go down, businesses will benefit, right? Because it will mean more spending for consumer, or more disposable income for consumer, which will mean more spending, which will mean more business growth and more profit, right? But that keeps rates, it really drives interest rates. You can even look at gold. It is the same thing. As interest rates bottomed out around gold, things that propelled gold higher, it's rising, right? Yes, there are other factors that control it or that affect the price of gold, because remember, it's a commodity, so supply and demand, all of that, and risk environment. But essentially, it is everything is because the US 10-year yield is a benchmark yield or a benchmark interest rate. And like I said, it is a world reserve currency. So anything that happens in the United States is going to affect every single economy. It's going to even affect us as South Africans. Why? Because our debt is denominated in dollar. We borrow a lot of money from the US. So if interest rates are going up in the US, that means that now as South Africa, we are paying more. So that is why the US 10-year yield or interest rates in the United States, different asset classes. But I hope that answers your question, Humphrey. Interest rates drive everything, but you need to understand based on that. And then you can make better moves or better decisions in the market. And like I said, you don't focus on don't how can isolate variables when it comes to fundamental analysis. And as much as I'm telling you, yes, interest rates drive everything. And as you can see, because people need to see with a chart to actually trust it, but you need to also take into consideration all the other data. How is unemployment? How is PMIs? How is the health of the economy? How is GDP? You know, and all of those things. But it all starts with the understanding of interest rates and then inflation. What causes inflation to be high? What causes inflation to be low? And all of that. I hope I've answered your question there. Humphrey.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's 100% clear.
Okay, good to hear that. Our hour is almost over because, like I said, it's an hour to empower. I'm just here to answer questions. I think, Raymond, if you have a question, this will be your opportunity.
Hey, hello guys. No, on my end of things, with what everyone has been saying and what you have also explained, I feel like I have a clear idea with you saying how the interest rates, how they affect or the leading indicators and how the direction of the markets are going to be moving. I feel like I do understand everything with what everything that you have explained. So everything is clear on my end.
You're good. Okay,
Yeah.
100s, 100s. I appreciate that. When we started with Nick, I actually asked him, but maybe any of you guys as well, even though I've answered some of your questions, maybe what do you think was actually the, how can I put it, the struggle or the stumbling block in your trading, essentially. If you had an idea of it, if you don't, it's fine. It's fine, but I'd assume that if we're trading and we're looking to make money and we want to make progress, we'd be able to identify what is actually holding us back, what is limiting us.
Okay, so I have a question here. What can we do to, because it's clear that inflation is the has a lot of power, is powerful. Inflation is powerful. So what can we do to study more? Because I think need a lot of time to go deeper on inflation. What is it? So can you please guide us? What can we do to study inflation? And also I'm not sure if I heard you right, but you are talking about expectations. So in my mind, well, what I heard in my mind is that, okay, for example, if you go to, let's say, Forex Factory, you'll have the actual, the expected, the previous. So I'm not sure if you are talking about that type. So I want you to explain the expectation that you're talking about, the expectation. So I think the expectation is the clear. Yeah.
The expectations that you're talking about. Oh, sorry. Were you done with your question? I'm sorry to cut you off there.
Yes, I'll stand the
Okay.
question.
So the expectations that you are talking of right now are expectations when what when we're having data release or economic data release, whether it's CPI or whether it's whatever. Those expectations also matter, but those expectations are talking about the actual figure or the data that is released today. So if they're expecting it at 4%, that means that if it comes in at 4%, it won't really move the markets because it was expected, right? So it will only move the market if it comes in above expectations or below expectations, or above the previous and below the previous, right? So that is what will significantly move markets when it deviates from the expectations. How do you view expectations in this example of Forex Factory?
Yeah.
You view them as long as they are not a surprise to markets, they will not move the market. They will only move the market if they are a surprise. It's like you, if Nick, your girlfriend, or maybe your family, they like we're planning a birthday for you, or they don't tell you, but they plan a surprise birthday for you, and everyone is quiet. Your birthday comes up, you don't know if they're planning on anything, or you're not expecting anything, right? Because no one
Yeah.
said anything. Then when it comes on your
Yeah.
birthday, surprise, obviously you'll be surprised and you'll be full of emotion, right? There will be an emotional reaction to it because you'll be surprised. But then if along the process your friend comes and be like, hey, I heard that your family is planning a surprise birthday for you, but don't tell them, he's already spoiled the surprise. You now already know. And as much as you might act as if you didn't know, but you won't have the same reaction or the same feeling as if you had not known, right? As if it was a surprise. So I view it that way as well when it comes to markets. When it comes to the news release, when it comes to the economic calendar, that is how I view it. If it's what was expected, it's not a surprise because the market did not expect it today. They've been expecting it for some time. So it's not going to move markets. They've already priced that in. The only thing that's going to move markets, it's something that will be a surprise that will definitely give a what? A reaction that is a surprise reaction. So that is the first thing when it comes to those expectations. That is how you trade those. But when I talk about interest rate expectations, inflation expectations, I'm going back to, and yeah, like you said, remember you said you'd analyze, you'd find sort of the direction using fundamentals, but then you want it to happen now. That is where expectations come in. Expectations are telling you the future. You see what you are saying, that it does not happen now, it only happens later. That is with in line with expectation.
Yeah.
Expectations are just saying, based on this data that we had today, how does it impact the bigger picture? Not only uti CPI pumile namhlanje and it's only affecting inflation, but how does it impact the bigger picture? What are the expectations of the bigger picture moving forward because of this high inflation number that we got today? So markets always move on expectations. Markets do not. When the US 10-year yield was falling, remember, the Federal Reserve was still hiking interest rates. Was still hiking interest rates. They only started pausing interest rate hikes. Let's go to interest rates and let me see so that I do not say something that is not true. The last time they increased interest rates was in July 2023, from 5.25 in June, then 5.5 in July 2023. So this was the last time they increased interest rates around this point here. Go up. Why? Because interest rates expectations were still saying that because inflation seemed as if it was now rebounding higher. And then when they started falling here, the Fed, it's not like the Fed had already, they are cutting interest rates now. It was what? It is expectations based on the data that we're getting today in terms of how will it impact future decisions. If the data remains the same or it keeps on deteriorating, how will it impact future decisions? Oh, we'd expect the Federal Reserve to start cutting interest rates. Then what? That means now interest rate expectations from the markets or investors for interest rates to go lower, and then of course the interest rate will go lower, right? So that is how it works when it comes to expectations on a bigger scheme of things or from a bigger picture perspective, right? So there's two, those are different. Expectations for a news event, it needs to be a surprise factor for us to actually consider trading it, because if it comes out as expected, it's not a big deal. But these type of expectations, it's questions that how will it impact the future and future decisions of that central bank. And then the market works on that. When I started in 2021, started buying the dollar, and that's when I bought USD JPY. Why? Because I was expecting that interest rate would go up because inflation was already around 5% region. GDP was very high. So I was like, okay, the Fed will definitely have to increase interest rates because inflation is double their 2% target. But they only started increasing interest rates when in March 2022. But because as market participants work on expectations, that is what moves the market, expectations. It's not the actual, when the actual thing comes, yes, it also moves the market, but expectations lead up to that.
Oh, okay, that makes sense. So the second question was, how do we better do a better study or analysis of inflation?
First, okay, it's understanding what it is. I've done a video, probably you've watched it. That video that I posted on YouTube, 60 minutes to understand fundamentals. There I elaborated on what inflation is, what drives inflation, the two different types of inflation, which is cost push as well as demand push or demand pull, sorry, inflation. It's understanding those, and then anything further, you can read online. If you want further guidance, you can join my access to my spreadsheet, not the mentorship. If you really want to just focus on the data, then you can join my the access to the fundamental analysis spreadsheet where I post every single day what is happening on the news side of things. You get access to it for a month and you can renew it if you still want to. I post what is happening every single day. I give updates on any news events that you need to pay attention to. What are we expecting on those news events? What are the expectations? What is the bigger picture? And what could be a surprise factor if it's specifically to news that are based on the economic calendar. But if it's geopolitical, I also update on that. Then every Sunday we have a Zoom call where I join everyone together, even with the mentorship clients, we join together. Then I break down the markets. That's also an hour plus. I just break down the markets, everything, what happened the previous week, what are we expecting in the next week, how could we potentially play things, what impact will it have if it's inflation, what impact will it have if it comes out higher, if it comes out lower, what impact will it have? So that is essentially what I give. And then, of course, also trade signals. I've incorporated trade signals to that. That is the package comes with that. So trade signals, access to fundamental spreadsheet, news updates every single day. And then on Sunday, we have a group Zoom call, right? That is 550 if that is what you want. But like I said, you can watch the video on YouTube. Yeah. You can do studies on online. But if you understand what causes inflation, if you understand what it is, then more practice is what you need. You need more practice. You need more exposure to data and being able to interpret the data. That is also something that is very important, guys, for you to be able to interpret the data. Don't just take the number at face value. Be able to break down the number and see what impact it has on future expectations.
All right.
Yeah. I think
it's clear. Thank
you. Yeah. Gift, did you not want to ask something or say something?
Answered. Yeah, I was answered. So I have no any other questions. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, gentlemen. If then there's no one else. Yeah. Sorry. You can continue.
No, I just wanted to say thank you for the opportunity. That's all.
You're most welcome. You're most welcome, man. Most welcome.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you. Yeah.
Gentlemen, so if there's no one else with a question, then I think we'll end our session here.
Okay, thank you, sir. This is very, very valuable. Thank you. Thank you. So our next session, same time, Friday, yeah?
Yeah, Friday, same time.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Use the same link. Good. It's a recurring link, so we'll use the same link.
All right. Okay. Thank you, sir. God bless. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. God bless you too, man. Okay, guys, we're gonna end it here. So good night, everyone, and enjoy the rest of your weekend.
Oh, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Cheers.
Cheers. Yeah.